Hey, Peter.
Hey, Adam.
How does this sound? Sound good?
Well, it begs the question, why do I sound bad?
I'm Adam Maness.
And I'm Peter Martin.
And you're listening to the You'll Hear Podcast.
Music advice and inspiration flowing at
What's up with your hand when you say...
Man, I like to get a little bit...
Your arm is inspired.
An inspiration.
It's this new hoodie I have. Big shout out to...
Haynes. Give it up for Haynes.
Tarjay. And no, it's just a little flourish I like to give it. Inspiration. I'm trying to be inspiring.
That's great, man. Well, yeah. You know, I'm actually pretty excited. We've done some really serious, amazing interviews the last 2 weeks. We did an interview with Ron Carter, which was incredible. We did an interview last week with Nicholas Payton, which was enlightening and amazing. And we're kind of getting back to our bread and butter here, bud.
Yes, indeed. We are back to... Wait, what's our bread and butter? Now you got me nervous.
You know, BSing through the intro.
Oh, right.
Yeah. Trying to explain some things, maybe.
To be honest, we did put our fancy pants on a little bit for Mr. Carter and Mr. Payton. A little bit, you know.
Can I tell you something?
Yes.
It's so funny that you said fancy pants. I actually brought out some old jeans. You know how you have like a... I don't know. Do you have a fat box? Or a skinny box?
I do have a fat box, yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
So I found these jeans.
You might have to explain to people that...
So if you're like, Peter and I, and you yo-yo diet your whole adult life, and you lose weight and you gain weight, you have a fat box and you have a skinny box, and you're often just swapping out your clothes, especially, you know, hoodies can stay out all the time. But
that's right, yeah.
But things like jeans, like these are some skinny jeans that are not actually, they're now a little big on me, I'll be honest,
okay.
But they've got a hole in a very curious place, so...
Well, we
not
will...
Not my fancy pants is what I'm saying.
Okay, gotcha. Yeah. Well, that's what I'm saying. We had our fancy pants on the last couple of weeks. Now we're back to the informality.
Regular
the
old...
Congenial...
Smelly basement jeans.
Exactly, of the You'll Hear It podcast, right. Adam and Peter. So what's happening today?
Well, today we're asking the ever timeless, important question, why do I sound bad?
Well, we have an answer. I'm just looking here. You're working on the wrong thing.
That's right, yeah. We like to answer our own questions.
You'll hear it.
Yeah, that's right. Good night. So this is something that I think about a lot. So we get emails, lots of emails, and we get a lot of requests for things, and we see numbers on things of the material that we put out in the world, and it seems like a lot of people are always very interested in, like, what scale should I use, or what's this lick, or what's this voicing, or what's this chord, or this progression, or this substitution, or this alteration, and all that stuff is super interesting. But then they know all this stuff. Some of them have been playing for a long time. Some people know a lot of material, and they still don't sound great. And they're frustrated that they don't sound great.
You know?
It's not that they sound bad, actually. That was a little bit of a exaggeration. But they just don't sound like, you know, the great players that they love sound.
Yeah.
And when you ask them, like, well, what are you working on? And they're like, well, I'm working on this scale and all 12 keys. And you know what I mean? They're never working on the one thing that would make them sound great, which is really to solidify their rhythmic vocabulary, to have confidence in their rhythmic phrases, to learn the language of the music in a way that is applicable and not theoretical, right? So not what scale goes over what chord. That's such an easy thing to understand and teach. It just takes knowing it. Like, you can look at that, you can Google any of that, and you're going to get some kind of an answer.
Well, be careful now. Careful when you Google that.
I know. Well, and we do like to provide that here at Open Studio because it's like, it is an interesting thing to talk about. But that's not necessarily going to make you sound good. You could be playing all the right notes.
Yeah.
It could sound terrible.
Well, I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, but what today is going to be about is kind of demonstrating. This wouldn't even be something that you might practice, but more of a demonstration that you can sound good by using great rhythm, great rhythmic vocabulary, using any notes, essentially.
Yeah, no, it's great. And I think one lens to look at this as well is that, you know, learning the harmony, the advanced harmony, learning, you know, different melodic ways of getting around, really kind of inspiration for your improvisation. These things do get into the areas where you can information your way into kind of confusion and then not sounding great. So when we say, you know, why do I sound bad? You're working on the wrong thing. We want to be clear that there's a certain amount of information. It's a lot. that you need to have, but it you don't necessarily you need to accumulate it and then kind of trust yourself that it'll provide the foundation, the basis,
yeah,
that layer at all times for you to be able to really simplify once you go to actually work on your improvisation. And maybe that's a way for folks to be able to kind of you know, balance out, because they're like, wait, hold on a second, we're supposed to learn this, I'm supposed to learn this, I'm getting overwhelmed. It's like, how do you acquire this advanced ear training, advanced rhythmic conceptions, you know, ability to be able to shift between different grooves, ability to be able to play with others and to be able to make those adjustments. These things are very nuanced. They're advanced. They require a high level of skill in a number of different areas that when you start to put them together, if you use the same kind of analysis and kind of just punctuality to your attention to them, if you combine all those and try to keep up the same way you would as you're learning them and as you're working on them, you know, it's just not going to work. So it's not about like, well, let me forget all this stuff. It's like, how do you internalize and how do you automate and how do you learn that stuff? Just like we talk about really learning the form on a tune. That's probably the biggest foundation you can have, where you know it without having to think about it, so that you can really work on and be concentrating in the moment on the right thing.
But don't you think when it comes to improvisation, it's like, a lot of, especially beginner and intermediate players, are a little bit out of balance.
Yeah.
With what they're working on. Like, if you spent more time working on your rhythmic vocabulary than your harmonic or melodic vocabulary, you would sound better faster.
That's right. That's right. Because it's potentially an area that you can work yourself into action. It's sort of an advanced concept on it quicker. So, like, it's very, or at least, it's funny because a lot of people would say that that's not advanced, just repeating the same rhythm over and over again. But really being able to sit in the groove on, like, say, one note, which doesn't take a lot of harmonic or melodic ingenuity to be able to do, but to be able to really feel that groove and play it in a way that makes sense, that can sound great. And so you've basically simplified and stripped away everything else. So I'm just going to concentrate on this one thing, groove and feel.
Yeah.
Still an advanced thing in terms of, like, to be able to really hit it at a high level. But in fact, just as for a listener, perhaps more accessible, as a player, more accessible as well.
Absolutely. Well, let's get into it, man. So we're going to do four tunes. We've done these transcriptions in various Open Studio videos on YouTube. If you're not on our YouTube channel, go subscribe, because we do a lot of content there that's not here on the podcast. And if you're watching this on YouTube already, go ahead and subscribe and check out some of these other videos that we've made. So we're going to do Thelonious Monk, Straight No Chaser, Clifford Brown's solo on Sandu, Sonny Clark solo on Cheesecake from Dexter Gordon's Go, and Herbie Hancock's solo on People Music from Secrets. And like I said, these are all solos that
we've... You like that record, Secrets?
Oh, you know it's my favorite record of all time. So these are all solos that we've worked on. What we're going to do, though, is we're going to listen to the solo first ahead of time and check it out, like, for real on SoundSlice. But then we're going to take the pitches out of it. And you and I are going to replace the pitches with our own pitches.
Okay.
And you're going to see that...
Hold on, let me warm up.
No, it's going to be...
Oh, it's going to be at the keyboard.
I think if we do this right, it's going to be obvious that using these masters' rhythmic vocabulary with our own, probably not as sophisticated, even melodic vocabulary as what they are using, it's still going to sound awesome. Like, it's still going to be, it's going to get us, like, to the 90 yard line.
That's 10, not bad.
I was going to say 90%, then I switched the last second. 10 yard line.
Yeah.
Right?
So, which would be 90% of the way there.
90% of the way there. And then.
Gets us into the red zone.
Oh, God. Okay. That'd be 80%.
Oh, that's true.
Anyway, so let's go to the first one. So let's bring up Thelonious Monk, Straight No Chaser on SoundSlice, and we'll play it. And let's just listen to, we'll just listen to the head.
Okay.
Honestly, we could do this whole show on Monk tunes, right? Just on Monk compositions.
On that one chorus.
On that one chorus. Just on his rhythmic vocabulary of his compositions, not even counting his solos or other people's solos on his on his recordings. They're just, this is the language of the music that we're trying to improvise here. So it's great to learn these, internalize them. So let's bring up, by the way, we have a PDF here. It's in the description of the podcast. It's in the description of the video. Download it. You can follow along yourself, and you could check out this head, these solos, and the rhythmic vocabulary that's associated with them. And you could try it yourself.
That's
again,
right.
This isn't necessarily something that you would want to practice every day, but it is a really good example of, you know, man, I had a teacher in New York, Hal Galper, great pianist, who used to take your snare drum solo.
Yep.
And by that, he meant have that rhythmic vocabulary going in your head. Put the notes in there, whatever notes are going to work, but that rhythmic vocabulary is first.
And I'll just throw out there, this is the kind of thing when we talk about pacing in our practices, especially for you advanced kind of type A go-getters out there that are really trying to make some serious progress as improvisers, think about this kind of practice, this kind of improvisational exercise and activity as like you're almost periodizing your practice. So you might be doing some intense transcription, say perhaps even of this very track, or some other kind of, you know, very deep dive, very, very much, you know, delving into advanced ear training type of activities. And then you're almost like, it's almost like when you're working out a certain part of your body too hard and you're like, you need to take a little bit of a break and work out another part, or maybe even just a rest period.
Yeah.
So this is not necessarily total rest, but it's moving to another kind of approach to improvisation that can really balance things nicely. So when you're feeling overwhelmed and you're feeling like, oh man, I just can't hear this and
stuff. Take the harmony, take the scales out of it.
Right.
Just work on this. Play your snare drum solo.
That's right.
You know what I mean?
Yep.
So Peter, can we put up here the rhythmic up on so that we can see? Okay, cool.
Is that it?
Yeah. Okay. So check this out. Well, the first one, I'm not even going to play anything.
Okay.
I want you to play me this B flat blues. We're just going to do one chorus.
Okay.
I'm going to give you a tempo, and if you don't mind just accompanying me, and I'm going to play the melody, all right?
Okay.
No pitches.
Yep.
And I'm not going to play anything, actually. One, two, three. So that alone. Right there. I'm feeling it.
You're feeling it all right.
But
buddy.
You know what I mean? That sounds killing. Like, that's better than me trying to scat some solo of, like, you know, whatever lick of the day that I'm working on. Now, let's do another one, and I'm going to put some pitches to it, but I'm not going to do very much.
Okay.
I'm just going to, like, stay within two or three notes, probably.
Okay.
One, two, three, and. You know what I mean?
Yep.
Let's do another one. I'm just going to play a blues, but I'm going to try to stick to this rhythm using my own notes. One more. One, two, three, and. You could do a whole solo of just playing the rhythm to that head, playing in different notes. You know what I'm saying?
I could do 100 choruses of that. And this is kind of a nice, creative way of doing what we call restrictive practicing.
For sure.
You know, a very specific type of restrictive practice.
Well, and what you're also doing is you're sort of, again, you're doing that thing we like to do around here. You're walking in the shoes of these giants, right?
Yes.
And you're just getting to feel what it feels like to play like them, to where are they putting the beat. You know, this leads right into learning the solo by ear from the record, which is where you ultimately want to go. But if that's maybe a little too much for you at first, try just learning the rhythm, just being able to play your snare drum solo using these melodies.
And this is the type of skill, like if you check out when Charlie Rouse comes in, I'm sure it's Charlie Rouse on that recording.
I think so, yeah.
So when he comes in on the second chorus, how locked in to the rhythmic flavor and flair of Thelonious Monk, the way he plays that melody. I mean, it's kind of shocking, actually.
Yeah.
Like how he, you know, on a different instrument is. So like this
kind of.
They
had a great vibe, though.
They had a great vibe. But I mean, he was, Charlie Rouse was such a great listener and like would take the way Monk was phrasing it and just locked right in with that in a super exciting way.
All right, you want to try one?
I do.
Okay, let's go. Let's go to the next sound slice page of.
Oh, I don't get to try one on this.
Well, we're gonna kind of alternate.
Oh, we're gonna
take turns. Take turns. We got a lot to do today.
I feel like you're gonna have the good ones, but that's okay.
No, I mean you can do. Hey, you can do whatever you want, man. You can do whatever.
We're all good. Let's go to the next one. So we're gonna go.
You get Sandu. Sandu's the best.
Oh, I love Sandu.
All right, so we just have the first chorus of Clifford Brown's solo. Mm. So let's just listen to what that actually sounds like. Let's listen to what that actually sounds like. Here we go. Yeah. There's so much there.
Ooh.
So let's.
This is a little trickier one.
Okay. Well, we can. I think we should slow this way down.
No, let's do it. Let's do it.
No, let's do it. Like,
okay.
I mean, because you have to kind of. You're reading this. Like, you're just hearing. I mean, you probably know the solo really well, I'm assuming.
Wow. But, kind of put me on the spot there, big guy. That's right. No, I like this.
You
want
to try it?
Yeah, let's
do
it.
So, however you want to do it, do you want to do it just solo, solo piano? Do you want me to accompany you?
Let's see. So we pull up the. So there is the.
There's a lot going on.
A lot going on here. That's good. That's all right. It's all good here. Ding ding. Is that the one?
That's the one.
Okay. I like you've got some accents in here.
Well, I tried to like put the accents are really kind of the shape of the line where the line is at its peak.
Yep.
At the height of it. Mm-hmm. Just because that's where usually a lot of especially these players of this generation were like accenting.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
So this will be like I'll start on the solo break.
Yeah.
Do we want to give me a little bit before it or should I go right into it?
Right. Let's go right on it.
Okay.
One, two, three. And
Oops, that's actually a solo.
That's all right, it's all good. Yeah. See what I'm saying?
I can do better.
You want to try it again? Isn't that great, though? It's
so
much
great.
Fun to try to do because you get to kind of live in his world for a little bit. Let's try it again.
I want to get it a little more accurate,
two,
though.
Three, and...
That's so fun.
You know,
so fun.
Like you get to really feel the flow. Okay, let's move on.
You know, one thing I noticed on there in the 11th bar, well, really the ninth bar of the blues, that the way that phrase playing with the pickup, that. Is, you know, because a lot of times, I mean, like if you're going to, which is cool, but this is like, gang.
Yeah,
like
yeah,
it's
yeah.
Like a like at a little different place that sounded great but felt a little uncomfortable to me, but this kind of forced me into it and now maybe it'll become a little bit part of my vocabulary.
So I'm saying, and I mean if you obviously if you add the melody in, like if you learn the solo by ear and you learn the notes he's playing, it's like even at a next level.
Yeah,
but breaking it down to just the rhythm is very eye-opening, especially if you're a player that's frustrated by the amount of just running your fingers over your instrument,
yep,
and like playing the same old stuff. Doing exercise like this can be big time
nice
help.
I'm thinking, because I kind of know, I mean, I've just heard this so much, I feel like I know the solo. That actually makes it a little harder because
you start playing the solo.
I'm hearing it, but that makes it so this is actually a great thing to practice. People are always like, I learned the solo, what do I do now? I'm just playing it.
Yeah.
This is something that you can do. A nice little challenge to take that rhythmic structure, that rhythmic format, that rhythmic form, and turn it into something
else.
Don't
sound bad. Work on your rhythmic vocabulary. All right,
that's right.
Peter, I'm going to give you, this is Peter's choice here. Do you want to take cheesecake and I'll take people music, or do you want to take?
I mean, you know, you're not even asking me that. You know, you want people music. You love that record. You have any faults, it's that you love that. Yeah.
I want to give you the option.
I'll take the cheesecake.
Okay.
It's all good.
All right. So up next is Sonny Clark solo. Just the first chorus of Sonny Clark solo. From Cheesecake, from Dexter Gordon's classic album, Go. Hold on.
Okay, that's okay.
Put it back
okay
up there. It's all right. It's all right. They can see behind that.
Wait.
All right, it's good to go. Okay. Classic album, Go.
Yeah.
And man, this is, first of all, the solo is just unbelievable anyway. But check out the rhythmic. So if you look at it, if you download the PDF and you look at the sheet music, it looks like a lot of eighth notes, but it's not. Check it out. That's what we have. Let's listen to it one more time, just from the record, because it kind of goes by fast. And again, we can slow this way down. So much vocabulary in this. It's like talking. He's talking for sure.
Fantastic.
So, and these are great changes too over Cheesecake. A bit of a minor blues vibe. You want to give it a go?
Yeah. How does that? Is that it there?
Oh, that's no,
let's
it.
Come back
yeah,
here.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That was it.
Bang.
Okay. Yep.
All right. This will be a. It's gonna be a little challenge to get my music going here.
This is a tough one. This is gonna be a tough one because you also have changes to deal with. So you know,
yeah.
Not
well,
to tell you your business, but you might.
I hope you enjoy people music.
I know. Look at.
I got you.
I know.
Got two chords going there. Three chords.
We're gonna go pretty slowly here.
It doesn't have to be too slow.
And so I'll give you that whole C minor bar.
Okay.
One, two, three, and.
that was piss poor. I apologize.
That was like back in music school.
That was not good.
Let's do it again.
Because you know what was bad about that? It didn't sound. I didn't play a good solo, and I was not accurate to the rhythms. At a certain point, I kind of panicked and was like, you know what? Let me just go back to one note, because that's the whole point of it.
That's the whole point.
And it still didn't sound good.
Let's try. One, two, three.
Wait. Hold on. I gotta pull this up. Oh, sorry. Okay. There we go.
Two, three, and.
Wait, start again. I wasn't feeling it. Now I'm feeling it. Let's go.
Two, three, and. Awesome. See what I'm saying? Man, that sounded great.
Man, if I could keep improving like that, it would sound good by the eighth or ninth time, which is really the way to practice this, though.
But this is
That's what's up on this, you
it's
know?
So good. All right, I'm going to take on people music. This is going to be the hardest one, I think. Oh. I gave myself the hardest one, just so you know, just for your benefit.
If only you knew it better. If only you loved it more.
What? No, I don't know this.
Here we go. Okay, now see, he's not ready. He's not ready.
I'm not
ready. Ain't ready. He ain't ready for y'all. Now, I would just say, as he's pulling that up, on that one, playing it slower, not to make excuses for myself again, but actually to recommend practicing at that tempo, that's where it's at. That's, you know, if you can get around these changes and you kind of can read these rhythms or start to learn them, it'll actually be a little easier at like this tempo. But practice at that slower tempo where you're exposed, where you have to really get these rhythms to lay within the groove in a way that you're hearing the spacing of those eighth notes, of those eighth note triplets, of those 16th notes. It's painful, and you're going to play a little faster and be like, oh, I can sound good. But if you can't sound good with it playing slower, you need to be practicing at that tempo.
Agreed.
Yeah.
Agreed. All right, cue me up here, Pete. Let's do it, man. You ready?
Yeah.
I love this. This is going to be hard to not just play the solo. I'm ready. I'm ready. I'm ready.
He's ready.
All right, here we go. Hold up.
You like that one? You like that one? Is that it there? Is that what's up?
Okay. Can you give me a compliment?
Oh yeah.
I'm gonna give you two beats. Well, and we're in.
Let me get my chart going here.
I'm gonna keep it simple here at first, man. I've learned from your mistakes.
Wait, what is that? What do you clap? What do you?
I took it.
Okay. I thought you were doing like a one, a two, a one. There, jazz, go.
One, three, a one.
Okay. One. Oh wait, did I go
Come
too
on,
early?
Sorry, Peter, man. I'm just getting.
I just
want
to give you a chance. So is that a pick up there?
Yeah, I'm just gonna give you two, and then so. Okay. Ready?
Yeah.
One, two, three. A go go to ga go to ga 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 chick aunt aunt ga aunt da 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 Okay, one more time, and I'm gonna add some notes here. Ready?
All right.
One, two, three. I need more time for accuracy. Yeah, I got the spirit. I got the spirit. Good. Here we go.
Should we go a little faster, you think?
Yeah. One, two, three. You know what I mean? That was decent solo for my second time through. Because Herbie's rhythm. Here's the other thing. Have you noticed something about doing four of these from four of these players?
Yeah.
Even though we're playing such kind of weak, like melodic stuff, for sure, because we're just trying to get the rhythm.
Yeah.
It sounds like those players. Like that sounds like a Herbie.
That's
even though I'm not playing anything Herbie would play melodically because I'm just kind of reading this rhythm. It sounds like a Herbie solo because of his phrasing, because of his rhythm. No, that's what you get from this.
Absolutely. And even when it's like man, that's totally That's the vibe. That's the vibe.
Getting that vocabulary, like being able to be free with that and then adding your own.
Yeah.
Ah. I'm just doing all my Herbie stuff. Just turned into just
no,
the Herbie
but it's
fest.
Totally, and maybe even a way to practice too is like you could get going, especially a little company.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah, yeah. Beat on the drum. Play your snare drum solo.
Yeah, man.
Peter, I think we got it, man. I think that was a decent demonstration of how some rhythmic vocabulary you like seem relieved.
Yeah, I'm like woo.
reading and stuff. But
no,
you know
but
what?
You know what? This is a nice little sight reading exercise too, because folks are always asking about how do you work on sight reading.
Yeah.
A lot of times we're sending them to, you know, the classical stuff, the sonatinas and stuff, a different kind of reading. But if you think about the types of things that we would likely come into contact with reading, studio work, you know, big band stuff, funk charts or whatever, these different grooves, lead sheets, chords, a lot of it is about being able to read complex rhythms quickly and accurately and being able to visualize
yeah.
them and then take them. So this is some excellent sight reading stuff
well,
I would
the,
recommend.
And I kind of sprung this on you because if we were to do this really right, we would just learn this by ear, right? We would
yeah.
like learn the rhythms, just be able to sing the rhythms. And so I encourage you, if you want to get better at music, learn a chorus of a Clifford Brown solo by just learning the snare drum solo
right.
rhythm, like, you know, a da 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 da, maybe the general
right.
shape. You don't even have to know the notes, but like, you hear actually, you hear like old jazz musicians do this all the time. Where they'll be like, ba dop bow, shabaka do wa gadu, ga ga ga, like all that stuff.
Yeah,
you know
yeah,
I mean?
Yeah.
That's part of it, man. That's part
yeah.
of the feeling.
That's right. Sorry, I noodled a little bit behind you because
keep
I was
noodling.
Trying to demonstrate
keep
what
noodling.
You were doing. This is great, man. I'm really inspired to practice some of this stuff and incorporating it into my routine. And again, I just recommend folks, when you're looking, don't feel like, okay, now I've got another thing I have to practice every day. No, this is when you want a little bit of a change of pace, a little bit, you know, look at something, a solo or a player or just, you know, these fragments, maybe something, maybe you don't know any of these or maybe you know half of them. Maybe you can look at them through a little bit of a different prism and then apply that to your practice in a really simple, isolated way.
Love it. Peter, this was super fun. Thank you, everybody. Of course, we're sponsored by Open Studio. Go to openstudiojazz.com.
That's right.
For all of your jazz lesson needs. Are we going to play it out or are we going to go out?
Let's,
what are we doing?
No, let's play the thing. We're going to play along with it.
Let's do it. Here we go. You'll hear it.
You'll hear it.
You'll hear it, everybody. Chronic noodling at the end.
I was noodling to myself. I was self-noodling. Well, I was trying to demonstrate.
Hey, can't do that on YouTube, buddy.
That's right.
Can't self-noodle on YouTube. They won't let you do that, for
that's
sure.
Right. No, but I was...
That's got to be behind the paywall.
I had a final idea to, like, demonstrate kind of demonstrate what we were talking about over that, but it was like, as you're fading out, I was like, Alright, what'd y'all think? That was a nice little concept that I came up with. I'm glad I texted that to Adam this morning.
Oh, you're so good at that kind of stuff. No, it seems like y'all are digging it. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Let us know. Don't forget to download the PDF there, folks. It's yours for the taking, where you can see just the rhythmic vocabulary of these players. But I was serious at the end. We should have made more note of that you don't actually have to write these rhythms out like I sprung on you today. You should learn them by ear and be able to...
That's right. Yeah. But I think if you have access like to this, and you know what? Maybe we'll do a little... mini course or something where we did this, wrote this out, you know, with Max on a bunch of cool solos.
Oh, man.
Because I think if you do have, you know me, normally I'm like, dude, don't be looking at the page. Yeah, how many times I've been like, no, don't give him a PDF. But because of the kind of ancillary, I don't know if that's the right word, ancillary.
Ancillary?
Ancillary. Oh, a poet and a prophet. Look at that.
He's a reader more than he is a speaker.
I'm the ideas guy. I'm not the execution guy, you know. Ancillary usage of working on the specific type of sight reading skills that can come in handy. I'm very excited.
You were
excited
into
about
the
that.
Sight reading skills.
Yeah, because, you know, I mean, I you know what it is? I think that reading and developing that is very important. It's just not important in the way that most people work on it, where you're learning a solo and they're actually trying to learn what in essence is ear training.
For sure.
You know, so that part needs to be done away from the page. But this part of being able to read better, being able to pattern recognize, which is very important for, I mean, it's like, you know, I always talk about my dad being such a great musician. One of his really good skills is like sight reading. Like, you can give him anything.
Yeah, those guys are so amazing.
Yeah, because he's seen it so many times, yeah. But it's not about you're reading it like it's the first time. You're glancing at the whole thing, pattern recognizing, breaking it down, and then saying, oh, okay, you know, now we're going to execute on that.
But don't you think that the work too of like just seeing the rhythm without the burden of harmony or melody, right? Without the burden of like what we get, especially pianists, man, we geek out so hard on, yes, what scale goes over what chord and all that crap,
right?
Which is not crap. It actually is really fun and really makes, you know, music. But this is often overlooked. Like, you often preach learning the Freddie Freeloader solo from Wynton Kelly, right? Imagine, think about the rhythm of that solo.
Pop. Spa ba bop, Scooby Dee bop, Scooby Dee bop, Boo doo ba ba boo dee ska, Scoolia bee bop, Boo doo ba ka da ba doo boo doo bop, Boo doo ba ga boo ga dee ga da ga 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 ga. Shab doob wee bop. Yeah, but that's what it is, and that's like the accent, like all that just comes easy to me because I know the solo so well, and I think not even so much from learning and playing, just from listening to so much. So it's like those rhythmic phrases and how they're delineated throughout the choruses as they go by,
yeah,
are very clear in my mind in a kind of a automatic way.
Awesome. Well, we have a little time, folks, and we'll lop all this off later. But if anybody...
Oh, so you know you're about to get some premium content.
No, if anybody...
We're going to lop all this off later.
I mean, we haven't done a Q&A in a
long
time.
Let's do a little
Q&A.
Absolutely.
If anybody has any questions or
whatever.
Yeah,
let's go into the comments for a sec. We do have that meeting to go to, don't forget.
Oh, yeah, we got a meeting.
No, but we're good. We're good. We got a couple minutes.
IRL meeting. What the hell is that all about?
Well, it's very exciting because it's perhaps our new podcasting suite, so we're excited about that.
Babel Brooksy loves noodles, don't we all?
I know. I have a surprise in the noodle realm that will be coming out next week.
Oh, could you release Peter Martin's noodly noodles? Cup of noodles?
Couple ramen noodles, that's right. Vegan ramen noodles. Weed and Wine says, I just work my way up from the bottom. If you put I'm very much like a squirrel, whatever's in front of me at the latest. Currently working my way through the Freddie Freeloader solo. Wynton's rhythm is king, and some days I'm just practicing the rhythm rather than working out the next phrase. That's what we're talking about.
Oh, man, Gerald Stevens, I am old enough that I used to bump Secrets on cassette tape. Gerald!
Come on.
You and me, buddy.
But I want to know, was that like the pre-recorded CBS cassette? Because that was with the Dolby NR in effect? Probably so. Or was that a pirated cassette? Perhaps Maxell or Fuji.
The Maxell. You could fit like three albums on a Maxell.
Yeah, and remember if you were willing to go with some lower quality, you could fit like six albums, like the slow speed.
Mm.
You don't know nothing about that.
I don't.
What about 8-track? What you know about that?
I don't know anything about that.
Me neither. But I saw it on YouTube. Cool. We got any other comments? Or Hal Galper equals Quiet Hands. Taking the anxiety out of the activity. Is that something that he preached?
Yeah, you know that scene in Ratatouille where the very stoic and sort of mean critic takes one bite of the rat's ratatouille and he goes back to his childhood because of the sense memory?
Yeah.
Hal Galper Quiet Hands just took me in that instant back to like the new school in 2001.
That's right.
Wow.
So we had a question from Brazil. What's up, Alex? Tudo bom?
Tudo bom.
Hi from Brazil. The most frequent question, where do I start with jazz in bass? So I'm assuming you mean playing the bass. Would you say that? Or are we talking piano in the bass region? Probably playing the bass.
Yeah, Alex, do you mean the bass like as in like upright bass or bass guitar or playing bass lines with like on a piano?
Yeah.
Specify, please.
Yeah.
Noriko says, related to rhythm in a band setting, who is leading the rhythm, or who is supposed to, or should listen? We should listen to each other.
The music should lead the rhythm.
Yeah, everybody ideally is responsible for holding that, for sure.
And I think that sometimes people would say, oh, well, wow, that's not always the case, because sometimes really good musicians, often drummers, take control of things and are like, everybody get on my back, I'm going to lead you. But I would just say this, that might be a less than ideal situation, in that that's what the music requires.
Yeah.
You know, like really good players, and this is not to say that it's always on the shoulders of the drummer, it's just, but that's just sort of one of the responsibilities, I would say. If things are kind of all locked in, there's everybody's interpretation of where the beat is, and that, I believe, goes to defining what the groove, the collective groove is.
Yeah.
And this is the great advantage of playing with other people, what can be accomplished besides just playing yourself. Now, at piano, sometimes we do get into a way of playing where it's like left hand and right hand, maybe even three zones, four zones, where that you're if you can start to kind of think like a couple of people, it can get exciting like that too. But the great thing about playing with the group is, even if everyone's an incredible player, you're still going to have slightly different human variations to the approach to what the time and the groove and the feel are, which is actually where the greatness happens. So if you talk about great rhythm section, great bands, great horn sections, it's not that they're so in sync that they're precisely playing together. Great string sections in orchestras, like to get that blend, you need a little bit of a different approach. And I believe there needs to be a little bit of a tension there, but that's based upon a trust. It's not based upon no one can keep the time and the groove except me, so I have to lead our things. That's okay, and sometimes that happens because you have players of different skill level, no problem. So you want to go with the one that's really carrying things. But if you think about like a relay team of runners, you have four different runners. They're not all machines, and they're not going to all run at the same speed, but maybe one is a little better at handing off. One starts good because they're real intimidating to the other team. I mean, like, there's all these nuances. So it's not just a numbers game of you add up the numbers. Same thing with music. So we want to ideally all be following the music and the kind of collective groove, but also know that there's going to be a certain amount of tension. I always think that the greatest bass drum combinations, especially if you look at things on the grid,
I know what you're going to say, it's true,
there's a little bit of tension,
there's
between
a little
them.
Tension, it's not perfect,
absolutely. Yeah, I remember for several years, I mean many years in different situations, but particularly playing with Roy Harger when the rhythm section was Greg Hutchinson and Roddy Whittaker.
Yeah.
And everybody was like, oh my god, that's one of the best bass drum combinations of any time, but especially of that period. And I would agree. But when people, like, they're so locked in, I'm like, yeah, but listen to, like, I was there for a lot of arguments. Come on, man.
There's tension
in there because they care. And because, but that ultimately adds to the excitement. And it's not the kind of tension
but
where it's like falling apart.
That's part of the human conversation of making music together, though.
Yes.
We're not robots, and we don't lock in like on a quantized grid, right?
Right.
Just like if you were to get those two guys together to hang,
yeah,
like I'm sure they got along just fine, but there's some tension.
No, they hate each other, but that's another
that's a whole other thing.
Just kidding.
No. But like, you know what I mean? It's like when in any group of people, if you had a quartet up here playing, there would be rhythmic tension, and if you could see them hanging at the bar afterwards, there would be a certain amount of, I mean, there would be more, consonants than tension,
sure.
For sure. But there is always personal tension, always universal tension between all beings, and that's part of it. And if there wasn't, it would be super boring.
That's right. I mean, it's a relationship, and just like any successful relationships, they are not interesting if there's no tension there. Now, if there's always tension there and there's not an agreement for what the overall goal is, then that relationship, musical or human relationship, won't work, and we've seen that. But the idea is that, like, you have to agree on where you want to get, and that's why we say the music leads things.
Always.
Because you want them, but this music is not preordained or prescribed in advance. So if you get people that are flexible and don't know exactly where it is you're going, but you know you want it to be great, you're committing to that, then that there's going to be a little tension, because not everyone's going to look at that path as the same. So it's like, no, come over here. No, come over here. Okay, let's meet in the middle. Oh, you know what? Now I'm going to lead you along a little bit. Those are very nuanced things. But all this stuff we're talking about practicing, and this kind of practice we went over today, on an individual level, these are the things that you would work on that you can really be able to bring your A game. Because, we've all been in these situations, and hopefully everybody here has musically, at different times, we hope to have it all the time, but this situation, when you're on the bandstand and you look around, and not even you look around, you listen around, and you're like, wow, this is the big leagues.
Yeah.
This is the A players here. Yeah, you know, and it's so exciting because it puts something upon every time I've been in that situation, I'm like, wow, okay, let me really concentrate here and bring my A game.
Yeah.
That's all I can do is I can only bring my A game. Bring the best that I can. Hopefully it's an A game.
Yeah.
But so but if everybody's collectively doing it, it's not about like who do I need to lead, who do I not. Like I might be just barely holding on for dear life. Because this is that these A players are just bringing it and they're concentrating so well. But then you also get that collective, you know, the sum of the parts is greater than these individual things, even if those individuals are great. So these are the kinds of things that if you work on them, you're going to put yourself in a better position to be able to represent hard.
True. Robert has a good question here. Do you think the same goes for comping too, i.e. the main thing being rhythmic placement rather than chord choices? So again, not to disparage any kind of like work on harmony or learning specific voicings, but it's much more important that your rhythm is solid,
yes.
I think, when you're comping. Like, let's do a little bit of that Freddie Freeloader. Peter, can you give me a bass line?
Yep.
I'm going to do two notes, Robert. I'm going to comp with two notes in my left hand. And I'm going to do the Hal Galper thing. I'm going to take my snare drum solo. You're going to hear me like solo rhythmically with my mouth. I'm going to try to play about half of what I solo with my mouth.
Okay.
One, two, three, four. B flat? Sorry.
You said Freddie Freeloader.
Okay. So I'm literally just doing the guide tones, right? I'm literally just doing the sevenths and the thirds that whole time. Once we found the right key, sorry about that. But once you do that, just finding your rhythmic vocabulary there, as I found eventually, finding that rhythmic vocabulary, playing less than you're actually listening, than you're actually hearing in your head,
right?
And you're going to be strong. Now, this we're taking away the fact that when you're actually comping for people, there's usually a soloist. And so you need to like account for that too. That's what you should be listening to serve the music first and foremost. So your rhythmic, how you fit in rhythmically with what the soloist is playing is really more important than any, I think, harmony that you play. Although you don't want to clash either with them, of course. Like it's all important. But I think the rhythmic element of that, like people practice their two-handed voicings out of time.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? With no rhythm,
right?
Like practice to a metronome,
the reference point of where they're going to actually exist and how they're going to be placed, you're totally stripping that away.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And I would just say too that kind of working with the theme of and hopefully to kind of crystallize this concept, we're not saying that the voicings and getting new voicings and learning, you know, how you're going to use them in a progression and fit them together with good voicing, all this stuff is super important. It's just that in there's a certain amount of attention to that in real time that you really, it's almost counterproductive to be able to practice like that if you're playing with other people, especially. So in other words, the time to think about trying out new voicings is not as you're comping behind someone, but you just have to kind of go with the ones that you have. But you can think about hip rhythms and like how you're laying in the groove. In fact, that is the time if you're going to think about anything. All this is about getting to the point where you can just think about and being reactive in the moment, not only to the other players, but to the, what we were talking about before in terms of the music as a whole. Like, what do I need to play to make this sound great? But it's more the time to think about one thing at a time, which would be the rhythm, simplifying things, and don't worry so much. Look, because you can't build up different voicings in real time. That's just not going to happen. But rhythmic placement and accuracy and playing within the groove is something that you can work on if you're just concentrating. So you would be taking, as you just did, something very basic that you already know, and then leave it to a different kind of practice to really start building up those other voicings.
Janet asks, if you're taking turns being in charge of dictating the rhythm, how do you negotiate taking turns?
Well, you got to get both your attorneys in the same room to get for that negotiation in advance, right?
It's like a conversation. How do you negotiate who's going to talk?
Yeah.
You know.
My turn.
My turn.
That's awkward.
That doesn't work. That doesn't work. It's not a conscious negotiation. It's a human interaction.
Yeah, and I think that just like this, that I love this idea of conversation. It's so important for piano players, for rhythm section players, but I would say for pianists and drummers in particular, because there's often two conversations going on, especially this kind of playing that we're demonstrating a lot today. As we're comping, like we're having that conversation with the drums, often the snare drum, while we're having a conversation, maybe a more supportive conversation with the soloist, the horn player, the singer, depending on how they're playing. We're taking the cue from them, but we're also stepping in. Just like if somebody's, you know, like if we're here, or say we're at a party and like, you know, we're with a group of like three, or hey, I want you to meet my friend Adam Maness. And man, Adam, tell him that great story about what happened to you last night. And you started, and I'm like, yeah, you know, like I can kind of be a little supportive. And then maybe I can support enough where I can sort of back away and go to another conversation. But I'm listening in the, you know, out of the corner of my eye. Okay, if he's about to go south and offend someone, I'm going to come in and help him or whatever.
Okay, let's do a demonstration. Patrick has a question. We're going to demonstrate a couple things. We're going to demonstrate Jan's thing and Patrick's thing. If you don't worry about the comping notes and prioritize the rhythm, can't you just play the notes from the chord scale as a voicing? See, Patrick, now you're onto something.
Yeah.
Now you know what professional pianists are doing. So, Peter, let's do that Freddie Freeloader. B flat this time, buddy.
Okay. Okay. I will do. No problem.
But if you don't mind, maybe take a little solo with it, and then I'll comp for you.
So my walking bass line? What am I doing?
Yeah, here? Walk a bass line, whatever you want to do, but maybe you got the solo. I'll comp for you.
Okay.
And I'm not going to do any voicings. I'm going to pick notes from the scales that we're going to be playing. And I'm going to, you know, try to also support you rhythmically as I would comp for you if you were a soloist, which you are.
Okay. Thank you.
One, two, one, two, three, and. That's great, man.
Yeah.
So what I was thinking there, Patrick, was just playing. I was literally just playing clusters from whatever chord we were on and just trying to. And actually, sometimes it wasn't even the chord. But then also, you know, you don't want to ape what Peter's doing. You don't want to do exactly the same rhythm jam. Like, you don't want to like dictate the conversation. This is his solo. But I want to give you ideas. I want to like support your ideas. I want to, when you go for something, I want to kind of if I get out of the way, I kind of want to get out of the way intentionally.
Yeah.
Or if I get busy with you, I want to make sure that that's intentional.
Get busy with it.
Yeah. But you know what I mean? Yeah. It's just, it's a conversation, right?
Yeah. And I think that, you know, the gray area, but really the exciting area of that is that it should not be a totally submissive thing for advanced kind of comping, because, you know, when you're going to kind of step in and be a little bit pejorative or a little bit suggestive or maybe a little bit, you know, a little bit getting all up in the grill for a minute. Like, you're always doing that based upon listening to what they're playing. But a lot of people think, oh, if you listen to somebody, then you're totally submissive in the way that you comp. And actually, if you're really listening, you're going to hear what's appropriate. It's the same thing, serving the music, right?
You have children. Right?
Yes.
It's almost like, you know, I'm just, as you were talking, I wasn't listening to a damn word you were saying. But I was
that's because you have children and you understand how to treat them.
No, but I was thinking, though, about how it's like your journey as an accompanist, right? When you start out, you're usually very bullish, like a child, right? Yeah. Like, you're just like, everything is what I say. Why can't we do what I want to do?
But that works good when they're like, when they're not talking back.
Exactly.
You know?
And then eventually you learn that you don't know everything. Like, you get into the real world, right? And you're like, okay, wait.
Wait, are we talking about the kids or the parents now?
No, I
wasn't listening to you.
We're talking about the kids. And so, like, you develop a little bit. Like, you understand you don't know everything. Oh, shoot. Like, I'm here to support the soloist. And you maybe defer a little too much.
Right.
But then as you – and you – like, remember, like, your first job or your first gig where you're like, oh, okay, like, whatever you say, sir.
Yeah.
You know, and maybe you're a little
too – Mr. Carter, whatever you say.
You're a little too deferential. But then as you get peers and you get older and you get more comfortable and confident – it's like you can support someone. You can be compassionate with them. You can be like friendly with them and make sure that they shine.
Yeah.
But then you could also, like, you read that, you're able to read them as an adult and be like, know when to get in there with them.
That's right.
You know, and be like, hey, you know what you need to do.
That's
right.
Right.
Sometimes that's cool and that's what they need. Right.
Yep.
It's just like that. There's no easy answer of like, well, and then in the second half of the third quadrant, this is when you want to be more busy. That's not right. How it works. This
robot comping.
No, it's not like that.
Well, this is awesome, man. We got an appointment to go to, so we are about to get out of here, but I want to thank you. This is Adam Maness. Those of you that don't know him, if you are new, consider subscribing because we're going live every Monday, 4 p.m. Eastern. And look, good evening. We got some folks over in Europe, and so good night, and some folks in Asia, folks in Brazil. Welcome to everybody. This is so fun. We're going to be back next week with something new. And what else we got, Adam?
We got peace. Peace, everybody.
Peace, everybody. Okay, wait, hold up. See?
I sprung it on him.
What do we know?
We got in there too quick.
What do you know about that?
Hey.